The problem with the paper is that the zippy parts that people are going to pick up on, for example, one is that MMT authors don't cite mainstream authors, that they ignore the mainstream, which is, you know, blatant, you know, it's just ridiculous. If you pick up, let's say, the MMT textbook by Mitchell and Ray and Watts, they have one section just on mainstream versus MMT, plus, you know, most sections will have, this is the mainstream theory, this is why it's defective, and it's commonly done. The reason why there wasn't a debate was because the mainstream, until a couple years ago, basically until the deficit myth was published, the mainstream pretended MMT didn't exist.
That's what I would like to see in the next paper, to say basically, okay, look, what you want, full employment and price stability, is also what we want. So let's discuss how things work. And then we would have a debate. And I think MMT will provide the framework for the answers that we'll find.
This is the MMT Podcast with Patricia Pino and Christian Riley. Hi, I'm Christian Riley, and welcome to the Modern Monetary Theory Podcast. You can find us on Twitter at MMT Podcast, and you can support the show by going to patreon.com/MMT Podcast. If this is your first time hearing about MMT, you might want to listen to our first three episodes for an introduction, which I've linked to in the show notes, along with some other things that relate to this particular episode. And as ever, I've linked to where you can support this podcast financially via patreon.com/MMT Podcast. Support starts at $1 a month or £1 a month or whatever the equivalent is wherever you live. And no matter what level of support you give, you get early access to all of our episodes and patron-only episodes where you can ask me and Patricia MMT questions. We're 100% listener-funded. Your financial support really helps keep the show going, and your support in other ways, whether it's by recommending us to other people or just by listening and spreading the word about this stuff, really helps too. A big thank you to all of our supporters so far, and thanks, as ever, for the time you put into understanding MMT. Let's dive in. Welcome one and all to the MMT Podcast. I'm Christian Riley. Unfortunately, my co-host Patricia is away for this episode, but I'm delighted to welcome back to the show economist and author Dirk Entz. Hi, Dirk.
Hi, Christian. Nice to be here again.
And joining us for the first time, financial consultant, writer for bondeconomics.com, and author of many titles, but most recently, Modern Monetary Theory and the Recovery. It's a pleasure to welcome Brian Romanchuk. Hi, Brian. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. Hi there, Christian. Hi, Dirk.
So our main topic is a recent paper put out by Christian Feister and Françoise Drumetz entitled The Meaning of MMT. And Brian, you quickly responded to this at bondeconomics.com with a piece entitled The Meaning of MMT? Yeah, sure. So it's a great title. Why don't you start out by telling us your overarching problem with the approach the authors took in writing this paper?
To give some background, I'm a very ex-academic and outside of economics, control systems engineering. But by a quirk of fate, actually, mainstream economics is based a lot on optimal control theory. So in some ways, some of the things that I studied in my doctorate came back and is useful for deciphering mainstream economics. But basically, when I was in academia, I was a bit of a grumpy person about academic standards and how they're slipping. And they were. And this paper, I mean, it's a working paper. It's not peer reviewed, but it certainly wouldn't be acceptable. I mean, that was the problem with the paper, is that it's really unacceptable as a academic paper. And, you know, the structure of the paper is, it's filled with a lot of stuff that might be true or debatable, but it's semi-plausible. But in between the sort of, you know, they cover background history of, you know, various debates, and but then they make, you know, sweeping generalizations about MMT in a single sentence. It's just a throwaway statement about MMT, but most of them were, you know, nonsensical. They're obviously wrong. And, you know, it sort of destroys the paper because they're just cheap shots at MMT, but they're not true. Like, you know, buried in there, there might be legitimate critiques, like which are being hashed over in a lot of debates over the years. Those parts, okay, that, you know, you could say, well, those are, you know, legitimate concerns that you can discuss. But the zippy parts that people are going to pick up on are just, you know, blatant statements. Like, for example, one is that MMT authors don't cite mainstream authors, that they ignore the mainstream, which is, you know, blatant. You know, it's just ridiculous. If you pick up, let's say, the MMT textbook by Mitchell and Ray and Watts, they have one section just on mainstream versus MMT, plus, you know, most sections will have, this is the mainstream theory, this is why it's defective, and is commonly done. The reason why there wasn't a debate was because the mainstream, until a couple years ago, basically, until the deficit myth was published, the mainstream pretended MMT didn't exist. There were no citations to it, no discussions. So, of course, I mean, the MMTers critiqued mainstream economists, but they were ignored. If one side ignores it, you can't have a debate. And that's it. So they said, well, the only reason they're complaining that, oh, they don't cite them now is because nobody cares what the mainstream authors are saying. And the deficit myth and so forth caught people's attention. And so now, well, you know, please listen to us. Well, I mean, it's just a ridiculous inversion of reality.
Yeah. And so MMT proponents are well familiar by now with the straw manning and the oversimplifications of the so-called critics of MMT. But this paper was kind of a little bit next level. So, Dirk, I was going to turn to you. I know your overall feeling was that the authors took a strange approach in terms of what they left out in terms of goalpost shifting. Could you tell us about that?
Yes. My first impression was when I finished the paper that there is something in it. Like, they say the money multiplier is wrong, and they know this. So I think that maybe they're open for debate. So I'm unsure whether their ideas of MMT are strange because they have not read the right stuff, or whether they were supposedly writing a takedown of MMT. So of course it's not an academic paper, so we should not expect scientific truths at all. It's a political paper. So maybe they were even ordered to write something like this. I'm not sure how it works exactly. But I mean, it says in the very beginning that these working papers reflect the opinions of the authors and do not necessarily express the views of the Banque de France, the euro system, and so on. So I think what is strange is that, first of all, they completely fail to understand that MMT is a lens, and that MMT is about balance sheets, and that MMT is about sequence. So it's a bit strange that they start with this discussion of Georg Friedrich Knapp and the state theory of money. That's very awkward, because MMT is not about history of economic thought. I mean, we kind of rediscovered these kind of theories from 100 years ago, but it's not that Warren Mosler, for example, read Knapp's book and said, oh, that's a great book, let's think about how this would work in today's world. So the beginning is kind of strange. What I'm very sympathetic to is the table that they start with, especially because they have the column in which they expose the mainstream view, they have it titled wrong, and the column in which they have the MMT view, they have it titled right. That's pretty good. It was a good start. But of course, almost all of that is wrong. So, I mean, if you look into the column, and I'm sure we get there, they clearly haven't understood MMT because they failed to appreciate the basics. So I think that we can definitely have a conversation, but we need to talk about the monetary mechanics, if you will. We need to talk about the balance sheet stuff. So they want to talk about the policy conclusions, but if you don't understand how a motor engine works, you won't be able to understand how a Formula One car or an Indy car moves. So we have to take one step back, and we have to shift away this whole discussion about history of economic thought. So I think these two authors are not historians of economic thought. They complain that Georg Friedrich Knapp in his state theory of money was not writing about the value of money. And there's a whole chapter on it. It just wasn't translated into the English version, but you should know about it if you're writing about these things. So also from a technical perspective, it's a paper which is full of omissions. As I said, Warren Mosler is not mentioned at all. Then they make no mention of John Yarmuth and the U.S. Biden administration, that they argue in terms of MMT. For them, it's MMT gaining prominence in the media and the public. But come on, I mean, it's politics now. And that seems like the way they start this paper and the way that these gaps show up, it might as well be that they wanted to write a paper which attacks MMT. And that is why scientific standards were loosened, let me put it like this.
Yeah, which is, you know, fair enough if they, you know, if their object was, okay, we are polemicists. But claiming that we're going to enter this into the world of ideas as something masquerading as scholarship is a little bit... I don't want to use swear words at this point. But anyway, so just rewinding to what it lacks in terms of rigor, the authors spend some time critiquing Knapp's state theory of money. And in the summary, they write, quote, although this is not explicitly stated by MMT economists, they, MMT economists, consider money as a pure asset that the state can create at will, whereas it is both an asset and a liability in the state theory of money. So in that regard, MMT represents a regression vis-a-vis the state theory of money, end quote. Now, I'll turn this one over to you, Brian. I mean, would you agree that that's how MMT economists view money?
You might have to ask the Dirk that one, because on my, I mean, I'm sort of, you know, a popular writer. I came into MMT, you know, sort of with ideas formed already. And I certainly didn't make that mistake. And I never saw anything that continue. I mean, you know, I'm sort of very skeptical about money in economic theory. And it's just, you know, it's a liability and government bonds are a liability. I cannot recall anyone in the MMT tradition that would say otherwise. I mean, they're doing balance sheets and money always shows up as a liability on the central bank. So, you know, it's just an offhand remark. It's an unsupported statement. They make a generalization about MMT. And it's like, based on what? Where did that come from? I have no idea. I mean, maybe someone said something somewhere that sounded like that. It's possible. But, you know, there, you know, that's sort of a misinterpretation of, you know, a vague, of, you know, if someone's writing a popularization, they could be right. You know, someone might have said something that could be easily misunderstood. But that's the thing. I mean, you know, in a, you know, that's always the risk with popularizations. And, you know, maybe it happened, but unless they can actually point to something, I have no idea where that's coming from.
Yeah. How about you, Dirk? You know, this idea that MMT economists consider money as pure asset rather than an asset and a liability. Where do you think that's come from?
Yeah, that's very strange. I don't know how they came up with that. So, I mean, if you read Knapp and his book, State Theory of Money, I mean, he says that government creates money and money is what is used for tax payments or other payments to the state. So in that sense, he doesn't talk about assets and liabilities. That's a big difference between Knapp and MMT. So MMT has this balance sheet method that what Warren is calling reserve accounting, that we're using this to understand how money is created. So Knapp's point, and the whole book is a bit strange because of that. So Knapp's point was that money is a state thing, and it's a state that is creating money, so it has nothing to do with economic laws or supposed economic laws, and that if you want to understand money, you have to understand the law. That's the first sentence, and he explains in the whole of the book why this sentence is correct, and there's not much more. So he doesn't talk about bank deposits. He doesn't talk about monetary policy. He doesn't talk about reserve accounting. So his book is really, it's a big book, but it's a simple idea. He knows this one big thing, and he says, look, the Austrians in the late 19th century, they didn't have any gold. They still created their own currency and it works. So he said, whatever you believe in terms of monetary theory, we have to deal with this. We have to somehow classify this kind of Austrian currency, which is a paper currency without any gold backing, which is still working. And that was his approach, basically. And when the authors here in this paper by the Banque de France, when they write that money is considered in MMT as a pure asset that the state can create at will, I don't know where they get this pure asset from. I mean, just as central banks, we put money as a liability for the government. I agree with Brian. I have no idea where they came up with this.
The only people that I've seen that from are actually monetarists. I've seen monetarists online, so they weren't necessarily academics, but there's a few people that pushed that, but they were definitely not in the MMT camp.
Mm-hmm. So the authors then go on to write, quote, regarding money, MMT makes a confusion between legal or fiat currency, i.e. the euro or the dollar, and cash, and does not signal the reason modern literature on money puts forward what makes legal currency quote unquote, acceptable by the public, i.e. monetary policy credibility, close quote. I mean, am I interpreting this correctly? It seems to be saying that we all use, say, pounds as our national currency here in the UK because we think the Bank of England's monetary policy is credible. I mean, is that what's being said there? Anyone?
Yeah, I would agree. So
That sounds right. I mean, this is sort of another overarching point about the paper, that they do something which is semi-legitimate. What they say, MMT says this, mainstream theory says something else. They can cite the papers. You know, since these papers are in the big journals, they're right, therefore MMT is wrong. You know, that's a debate. I mean, the good faith way of doing that is say, well, wait a second, does MMT have critiques of those source papers? And they don't delve into that. But you could argue, like, for example, like, let's defend their view. For example, if someone said, oh, I'm going to invent a perpetual motion machine, you know, a mechanical engineering prof would just start quoting, you know, these are the, you know, laws of thermodynamics, perpetual motion, it's out. And they would cite the thing. So you could argue that they're trying to do that, that this is settled science and MMT disagrees with the settled science. And you can look at examples like astronomy versus astrology, where you could say, look, the scientists would do that. And that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to say mainstream economics, you know, what makes the big journals is a settled science. You know, if that were true, well, then of course there's no need for MMT. But, you know, the problem is MMTers, MMT proponents have critiques of those theories. And that, you know, that has to be taken into account if you want to have a serious debate.
Mm, yeah. I mean, you know, obviously the mainstream doesn't have it nailed. It's not settled science, is it? What's your take on this idea of monetary policy credibility being the thing that makes legal currency acceptable?
I mean, if you're talking to me, I would say that's probably you could probably point to some mainstream theory that says that, but I've never seen that literature. If they had a citation, I didn't chase it down. Anyways, I'll let Dirk on it.
What do you say, Dirk?
I would think that this comes out of their modeling frameworks. So they are thinking about, clearly, they're thinking about inflation expectations in their models. They complain about MMT not exhibiting a money demand function. So for them, modern monetary theory is about looking at some kind of equilibrium model. And from this kind of perspective, so they're wearing these kind of glasses. From the modeling perspective, they're not happy with MMT because MMT talks about a lot of things, but it is not talking about the stuff that they have in their model. So they are a little bit out of they have no frame of reference really here. And that's what's confusing them. Okay, so I think that they also write and about currency competition and how MMT would not talk about currency competition. I mean, well, we write about exchange rates, right? So what do you mean by currency competition? But they see, because of the new liberal glasses, they see that if there's something which is like multiple currencies, they think, oh, it's competition. So it's not cooperation. Okay. It's not currency cooperation. So MMT doesn't talk about currency cooperation. Of course, we could talk about swap lines from the Fed and so on, which exists, but you can clearly see that they're wearing these kind of neoliberal glasses and they have these kind of models in their background. So I think for them, it is really, really hard to understand MMT, especially since they haven't understood that MMT is about balance sheets. And what I find sad is that they should have realized that MMT is falsifiable. Okay, so we have these balance sheet statements and we have these transactions. And well, you're welcome to falsify us. Okay, so they complain that we don't write about the fiscal monetary interactions. I mean, in my book, I have described how it works in the case of Germany. So what happens if the German federal government spends? Well, yeah, look at those balance sheets. And if you think that they are wrong, well, show me an alternative or explain to me why I'm wrong. I have no problem with that. So we could engage in a serious discussion of how things work on the ground. This balance sheet approach is also nothing that is alien to neoclassical authors. They use that as well, mostly for talking about financial crisis. But because they jumped in this very strange way, and they never got to the part where they talk about the balance sheets, and they never talk about, for example, how the French government actually spends. That's what I would like to talk about. So maybe there won't be a debate because they're not interested in the balance sheet operations, and we're not interested in trying to improve the dynamic stochastic general equilibrium model they're using. So in that sense, there might not be a debate in the end, but we'll see.
Yeah. Just on the currency competition point, I mean, that was another point that I saw and I was mystified by, because, I mean, I imagine if you did a literature survey, if you did a Google Scholar, is a fairly powerful tool, which I would love to have had when I was in academia. But if you search for currency competition, it might show no entries in the MMT literature, but it's because they probably just don't use that phrasing. But if you look at certainly the historical work, like Randall Ray, I have one of his earlier books is Understanding Modern Money, and he has a whole section on how colonial governments imposed monies in colonies in Africa, and they used force to impose a money on thing, and so it's driving out whatever economic forms pre-existed. It wasn't necessarily occurring. It might have been like gift economies. I can't remember what exactly he wrote at this point, but imposing a tax, you drive out the competition. And that's how you deal with the currency competition. So you don't talk about currency competition because that's just coming to the whole notion, of chartalism, that taxes drive the value of money, and you just impose a tax in the domestic currency and you just snuff out any competitors. Because let's say, Canada is stretched out on the U.S. border. And so it's fairly easy to go into, let's say, a restaurant in Montreal and actually pay for things with U.S. dollars. And nobody cares. There's no, legal. But it's not even close to driving it out because it's just a convenience that the restaurants offer. But, everyone has to pay value-added tax on all the transactions, and that's remitted in Canadian dollars. If they started taking in lots of U.S. dollars revenue, they're going to be getting a tax that has to be paid in Canadian dollars, and suddenly they've got an exchange rate risk on it's like 15% of their revenue. They're not going, they don't have the margins to absorb currency. So you can't. You can do things like, sure, cryptocurrencies exist, but that's because, hey, they're not paying tax. But if you're paying any sort of transactions, like you're paying workers or you have a value added tax, you pretty much have no choice but to match the currency that you're being taxed in. So It's really a non-issue for a country with a functioning strong tax system.
It seemed to me reading the paper that they think the state theory of money is incorrect and therefore MMT is incorrect because in their mind the state doesn't fully choose the unit of account. Like the unit of account is only permitted to become currency by the sentiment of the public that the government is governing. So sure, the state can choose any unit of account, but if the public don't think that unit of account is credible, back to central bank credibility or monetary policy credibility, if the public don't think the unit of account is credible, they'll stop using it. And they write about this concept that Dirk brought up, the currency competition and what we've just been talking about. But they seem to be saying to me the competition exists internal to the nation state. So the idea is it becomes kind of a cooperative arrangement rather than a coercive one, as in the MMT money story. It's the big counter argument to chartalism, the taxes drive currency framework. Is this really the big counter argument to chartalism, I guess, is what I'm asking.
No, I think what the main argument is here in their text is that they say that Ray and others would neglect that bank deposits have to be convertible, redeemed into legal tender. That seems to be the main issue in their critique. But that is of course ridiculous because we've said that 100 times and I mean, Randy was writing about these kind of issues, I think, in the early 90s already. So that is something where they're completely off. So, I mean, why are bank deposits denominated in euros? Okay, so of course, it's the state's currency, and that's it. So, I mean, NAP is relevant more than ever, I would say. And it's not convincing, this kind of part where they basically say that the state theory of money is better than MMT. And then they say, but it's still wrong. And it's outdated. Because this is also the argument at the very end that MMT would be outdated. But once again, it's very clear to me that, of course, we write about banking. And I mean, in my own book on the Eurozone, I have a full chapter on bank creation, and somehow they didn't find that either. So the gaps that they perceive in our theories are there because they just don't find the literature. So I think a consistent reply to all their points would be to point out where they should look to fill the gaps that they perceive.
One thing in... you know, reading it, I thought I saw it, but I didn't spot it again. I thought they made a passing remark that MMT ignores bank money.
Yeah.
I've seen that before. See, I in my latest book on it, you know, I sort of do a popularization of MMT, talking about the recovery after the pandemic. But I do have a chapter on critiques, and that sort of shows up. It's a very bizarre critique that they ignore bank money. The closest I can say is that if you look at a lot of MMT primers, the way they will discuss money might be really state money. Like the, you know, if you're going to get really finicky, it should be state-issued money, which would be like reserves. Then on top of that, you have the banking sector. Like you have the private sector creates liabilities that are money-like. They're layered on top of the governmental base. That was common. See, I never was confused by this because, I mean, the MMT presentation I saw first explained how, you know, private money is layered on top of public money. And this was just after the financial crisis, when I first ran to MMT. What we saw in the financial crisis was private money ceasing to become money and turning into long-dated liabilities. And it turned out that the private money wasn't really money. So that made perfect sense. And so I never even thought about it. I mean, the way it was introduced, but I can see that if you took some primers and take text out of context, yes, I mean, there might be, you know, really it's government money, but, you know, I don't really see the value of going after the exact wording used in MMT primers. You know, whatever. I mean, if you have a problem with the primer, just say, hey, what about this? And then say exactly, you know, this primer said this here, and then you can discuss that. But just making wild generalizations based on this it doesn't make sense.
Yeah, the authors seem to think that Randall Ray and therefore the other MMT economists don't understand endogenous money creation. So they write, quote, MMT has nothing new to bring regarding money creation by banks, whereas private money represents the bulk of money creation in modern economies, brackets, e.g. more than 90% of the broad money aggregate, M3 in the euro area, close brackets, end quote. So this idea that, oh, quote unquote, private banks create most of the money we use comes up time and time again as a stick to be MMT with. Dirk, how would you go about talking about that?
Yeah, that's a common misperception there. Or many people apparently don't understand that the state, when it spends, also creates bank deposits. Okay, so when the German government spends, for example, they buy an apple from me, so I get a euro. Oh, they probably overpay me on that, but anyway. So I get a euro in my bank account. So that's bank deposits. And of course, my bank gets a euro in reserves. That means that government spending creates bank deposits. And yeah, I've seen this also quite a lot, that the people say, well, but bank deposits are 97% of the money that we're using, and cash is only 3%, so state money is not important. But that, of course, is completely mistaken. And this is why, I mean, MMT has nothing to do with the monetarists. So the monetarists believe that these monetary quantities, that they are driving the economy, whereas we make the point that, look, one thing is aggregate demand and spending, and the other point is the amount of money creation, net money creation, that is associated with that. And that it means that, for example, every euro that is created by a bank loan has to be repaid. Okay, so yes, of course, private banks do create money, but they also cause flowback. reflux. So you have to look at the net thing. So it's not that they create money when they give out a loan, but they also take away money, take away bank deposits when loans are repaid. So I would think that, of course, over the long or the medium term, even net money creation by banks should be zero, because what they create will have to be paid back. But of course, when the government spends and the spending in the end is causing a deficit, then of course you create bank deposits that are there to stay in the monetary circuit, inside the economic circuit. So that's very important to understand. So we are not saying that only state money matters. It's people are confused because they say, well, these people are defining money in a different way. They're talking about the monetary base, like cash and reserves only. But that doesn't mean that in terms of macroeconomics, we only talk about cash and reserves. So again, that's because many people know the monetarist glasses, and that's what they are putting on apparently when they write about it like this.
Yeah, and to anybody sort of new or newish to this, the way I'd say it is this, and I'll just run it by you guys just to check that I'm not misspeaking. When people say, oh, 90-something, 97% of the money we use is, let's say, commercial banks, because as Warren likes to say, when it comes to money creation, banks, commercial banks are government agents. You know, you can't just, as a member of the private sector, plug your laptop into the banking system and start creating pounds or Canadian dollars or whatever. So, you know, banks are, franchised by the government to create money out of debt when they make loans. But when people say, oh, 97% of the money we use is bank-created money, commercial bank-created money, I often counter with, no, if by we you mean people with bank accounts and firms with bank accounts, then 100% of the money we use is a spreadsheet entry at a commercial bank. And, you know, it's about how those deposits got there in the first place. You know, it could have been lent into existence by private sector person going into debt to create that deposit and transferring it to you, or it could have been spent into existence by the process that MMT talks about, by the government, by, you know, creating an increase in bank reserves, which also creates an increase in commercial bank money. Does that sound fair to the panel?
Christian, I would even go further and say, look, the creation of private money through bank lending only works because people expect the government to spend. If you look at the US, for example, why is core inflation in the US so high? Why is employment, the rate of employment now better than in the Eurozone, for example? Well, because the government is spending trillions. Okay, and because the private firms are expecting to sell a lot of stuff, they also borrow money and they build more stuff, they update facilities, they buy more cars that they're using, they upgrade internet capability and so on. So all of this is just because they expect to do business with the government or with people who got money from the government. So I would always say that with Chaim Minsky, I mean, private debt is, in a way, it's a Ponzi scheme. Okay, so if government says tomorrow that their government spending will go to zero for the next 100 years, then of course all these private debts, they will not be able to be repaid. It just wouldn't work. So all of this private debt is contingent on the fact that the government will spend and continue to spend lots of money into the economy. So I would say that private bank money creation through bank loans is not independent from the government's money creation process at all.
Yeah, and on a technical note, I mean, if we're talking about M3, M3 includes, it's a broader aggregate, like the money supply numbers, they go from M0, monetary base, M1, which is monetary base plus, that's the bank deposits. But if we go to M3, it includes money market funds and repos and things like that. The exact definition might depend on the jurisdiction you're in. But money market fund, I mean, anyone, any entity that can sort of scrape together a good enough credit rating can issue money market paper, and it'll be picked up in a deposit. And that's the thing, like the M3, back when I was younger, I had $200 I kept in the bank, and as soon as my paycheck came, I swept it into a money market fund, basically in a brokerage account. So I had almost no bank money at any given time. I just sort of kept the minimum, I would pay bills as they would come in, and I wouldn't keep it there. I would park it in, instead of getting 0% in a bank, I would get, well, back in the day was a positive interest rate. And that's the thing, like, it's like, if we, let's say a repo sounds scary, but let's say you have a bond investor and they want to say, oh, I think interest rates are going to fall, bond prices go up. Buying bonds doesn't make much money by itself. You want to use leverage to get some interesting returns. So how do you leverage a bond position? You finance it with a repurchase agreement. A repo is a way of lending to someone to buy a bond. I mean, legally it's a buy-sell agreement, but economically it's like a margin loan. I can borrow against the collateral of a bond, and so suddenly I can be levered 20-1, and suddenly returns are really exciting again, because it's being levered by a big factor. Well, money market funds will own those repos. So that money was created by someone doing a leveraged position in a security, in the government, usually a government security. That has nothing to do with bank money creation. That is just, the financial sector being the financial sector, gambling on things. And you lever up short-term debt to take positions in long-term debt, that will show up in money market funds. And so it's all layered. And then what you saw in the financial crisis, when there's worries about repayment, that entire system falls apart. And then everyone retreats to government money. And MMTers talk about that. This is not, it doesn't make its way into every primer because this is something of interest to people in finance. But it's, that's the thing that has to be kept in mind. It's not just banks, as soon as you just talk about broad money. But, that broad money is used in a lot of transactions.
Good point. So the authors go on to write, quote, legal money can be created by banks. In fact, as reminded above, most of the money is created that way in modern economies, and taxes are nearly always paid in bank money, not in cash. Now, that says to me they're confused about at least a couple of things, but what would either of you say to these assertions?
Yeah, this is a European thing here, a Euro thing. Of course, it's where it gets interesting, okay? So this is where I would have liked to see the authors write down the balance sheets and say, look, this is what happens in France when people pay taxes. So, okay, we know that it looks like we're losing bank deposits, and it's probably true. So if I'm a French taxpayer, I have less money in my bank account than before, but then what happens? So will these bank deposits be transferred to an account held by the treasury at my bank? So if that would be true, then of course I would say, okay, the authors are correct, and that's how it works in France. And then that becomes part of MMT because we're learning. But I doubt that it works like this. So I would argue that probably just like almost everywhere else, the state, and we can go down even to the municipality level, they have their bank account with the Banque de France. And I'm pretty sure that the Banque de France would also self-describe as fiscal agent of the state. So if my bank has to make a transfer to the government's account at the French central bank, then of course they need reserves. So that's where reserves are coming in again. And that would be that. So I would really like to see their answers spelled out in balance sheets, because they're just using words and they have no references. They just claim it's true. But as I said, MMT is falsifiable. The monetary theory stuff either works this way or it doesn't. We can just look it up. We can ask people. We build the euro system. We must understand. We will have to know how it works, right? That's very simple. And I hope that in my reply that I'll write, I'll just point my finger to that. And then let's see whether they are open to this and they reply and discuss the fiscal monetary nexus of the French monetary system using the euro. I would be very up for that.
Just one sort of addendum. I don't know where I saw it, but I'm pretty sure it was Randall Ray. I've seen it a couple of times. But you pay with a check. But buries in an assumption, the check clears at par. And everyone assumes, if you write a $100 check, you're paying off a $100 debt. But that doesn't have to be true. If you look, let's say, in the United States before the advent of the Fed, what would happen is checks would not be cleared at par. You wrote a check on a bank that was a little bit dodgy to pay someone who's a stronger bank, that check might be at 90 cents. They'll give you 90 cents on the dollar for that check. And that's the thing. So you know, then suddenly bank money is not all equal. There's actually exchange rates. And back in the day, they would publish exchange rates on, you know, what are all these various bank monies worth? And one of the things, like the modern financial systems, the government imposed bank checks clear at par. And, you know, the regulatory, like, you know, so we don't, that worry disappears, but that's because it's backed by government and the banks get this privilege that, hey, their checks clear at par and can be used to pay taxes at par, but at the same time, they have to submit to regulation.
So on the topic of central banks, and we're going to get into the weeds a bit here, so apologies for that. The authors don't like the idea that the Treasury and Fed coordinate. And they write, quote, MMT never explains what this coordination consists in, instead letting the reader assume that the central bank would receive instructions from the Treasury that dictate the amount of liquidity to be provided or withdrawn. In fact, the central bank receives no more than the forecast by the Treasury of the changes it expects to take place on its account with the central bank over the forecasting period of the autonomous factors, i.e. the period before the next open market operation. Provided the quality of this forecast is not too poor, it helps the central bank in calibrating its liquidity auctions. Instead, Ray suggests that the Treasury would de facto dictate monetary policy through its issuance policy, and thus that central bank independence would be a myth. Without citing any legal text, Kelton, and they're referring to the deficit myth, I think, here, Kelton even elusively writes, quote, the Fed makes sure the primary dealers have all the funding they require to make it profitable for them to place reasonable bids for the entire Treasury's allotment, close quote. So there's a lot to unpack there, but I think I should start with you, Dirk.
Yeah, well, I think that there's a lot of myth here from their side, and this is why they are so confused. So first of all, central bank independence, there's even mainstream authors who are writing about the myth of central bank independence. I think it's a book by Binder and Spindle, American authors, so with German-sounding names. They apparently believe that somehow the central bank there is to rein in the treasury before it overspends. And they believe that there's monetary policy, which is setting interest rates, and there's fiscal policy, which is making payments for the government. And they think that these are two different things. But of course, when you understand MMT, you understand that these two things belong together. So every time the government spends, the central bank will be crediting a bank account held by a bank at the central bank. So there will be more reserves. And because the demand for reserves will not grow at the same rate, that means that the interbank market interest rate will have to fall. And this means that, and that's now the coordination that we're always talking about, that means that fiscal policy and monetary policy have to be coordinated. Because otherwise, every time that the government spends, the interest rate will go down. Every time the government taxes, the interest rate will go up. And that, of course, would be stupid. Okay, so if you want to have a stable interest rate, and you want to make sure that the government can spend via its central bank at the same time, without any interference, without any noise, then, of course, you need to come up with such kind of a system like we had with the bond issuance. Like in the US, they still do this, that every time that the American government spends a dollar, they sell a dollar in worth of government bonds, so that the extra liquidity is absorbed right away by purchases of government bonds. Of course, it's not necessary to do this anymore, because now we are using this corridor system. But because we are already running out of time, let me not get into the details here. But yeah, they kind of think that there's something like, they call this fiscal dominance, so that the central bank is so preoccupied with executing government spending that they lose control of the interest rate, okay? And that's what they call fiscal dominance. And then they call monetary dominance, where the priority of the central bank is just setting interest rates, and they just leave the government alone, and the government is just like a household. And that's how it works in their mind. It doesn't in reality, but it explains their framing of things. And I think there's very little to be learned from these kind of passages for us, because we've discussed this many times already.
Yeah, I mean, I could just jump and say, I mean, I certainly only heard about this from MMT authors. Like, whether there's, you know, it's explained perfectly everywhere, I can't say for sure. But certainly, I only sort of learned about this because of MMT authors. Maybe it was Warren Mosler. but like there's no vague instruction about bond issuance. Like the when the U.S. Treasury issues bonds, they announce the date and the amount of the issue. And so the central bank knows exactly what it's offsetting in advance. It's not like they have to guess. And as for, you know, that there's estimates, but that's always true. Like if we look at the sort of the way the Canadian system operated at least a few years ago, if you looked at it, every single bank at the end of the day ended up with a net zero position with the settlement system. Basically, every bank, including the central bank, ended the day with no reserves, you could call it. There weren't reserve requirements. So basically, everyone had zero. And every single bank, including the central bank, has to look at, okay, at the end of the day, oh, what are my flows been so far? Okay, I got to do something to close this out to zero. And, you know, to a certain extent, if the private banks do this, the central bank has to do it automatically because it's also a participant. Everyone else is zero. They end up with a net position zero. But they see the flow. I mean, the federal government banks, they have a single account with the Bank of Canada. You know, the Bank of Canada is seeing those flows, and so they know what they have to do to allow the private sector to net to zero as well. But that's it. And it's not like, you know, oh, well, the fiscal, you know, because you don't know. They send out a check. It can be cashed at any time, like within 6 months. So, of course, it's an estimate because you don't know when checks are to be cashed. Like, you only know what it roughly is, and there's no choice in them. It's ridiculous to pretend that you can tell exactly because you can't force people to cash checks on a particular date. You know, you don't know when people are going to pay tax, and you've got considerable leeway to pay tax. So the government can't tell you. You know, I pay as a consultant. I pay my taxes by installments, and I can pay it at any date before a deadline, and a penalty after they start charging me interest if I'm late. But so they don't know exactly when that's coming in. So you know, that just goes without saying.
So, Dirk, the authors feel that government debt could be unsustainable, and they draw on Krugman, and they write, if public debt reaches rapidly unsustainably high levels, i.e. if the interest rate on public debt is higher than the growth rate of the economy, exerting an upward pressure on interest rates, the government finds itself forced to run large primary surpluses, which may be politically difficult to achieve. The temptation to engage in some form of financial repression or debt restructuring or to ignite inflation would be irresistible, Argentina's example being a case in point. So in their mind, government debt has gotten to unsustainable levels in some cases. So MMT is wrong about government debt not having any limitations on the government's ability to spend. So what do you say to that, Dirk?
Yeah, this is really a puzzle to me. So you have MMT critiques. And first they say there's some kind of problem with debt sustainability and governments can run out of money and default. And then they say, but when you implement MMT, you will have hyperinflation like Venezuela or Zimbabwe, where it's very obvious that they don't run out of currency at all. Okay, so it's completely inconsistent here. So either you make the case and say, look, public debt can bite you, and at some point you will have runaway inflation, and then all of this leads to hyperinflation. But again, you're not going to run out of money. So the empirical reality shows us that MMT is correct. So we're not saying that Venezuela or Zimbabwe did the right thing when they did what they did. So they had episodes of hyperinflation, but the problem of running out of money never materialized. And it's the same with Japan, which has a deflationary problem. So you can't even make the argument that high levels of public debt to GDP caused it. I mean, in Venezuela, it's very easy to see what happened. I mean, the oil price came down, and that's when socialism for the 21st century a la Venezuela crashed. So what did the Venezuelans do? They used the dollars that they got through exporting oil. They purchased stuff from Colombia, like consumption goods, and then they put it into supermarkets. They put prices down, so the loss was going to the government, and said, look, here's cheap stuff for all of you, which was great for reducing poverty rates. But of course, it only worked until the oil price collapsed. So there's no way that you can somehow show that in Venezuela an increase in government spending or public deficits caused hyperinflation. And that is why I find this part very inconsistent, very inconsistently argued.
Mm. I know, Brian, you've got a whole chapter in your book of common critiques of MMT. So you've probably heard this one before.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm not as you know, as a government bond analyst, so I've seen this for a very long time. I mean, obviously, you know, government spending can be unsustainable in the sense that you eventually, if it sort of goes out of control, you get an inflation problem. That's usually what, you know, that would be the end result. And that's literally what MMT says, that the issue isn't default, the issue isn't running out of money, you're going to run into an inflation problem. And that's it. I mean, to be honest, that is the sensible mainstream authors have sort of come around. They've given up on the running out of money and they say, well, actually, the problem is inflation. And generally speaking, that's where the consensus is. Admittedly, right now in the US, they have the debt ceiling. Like you can have political. I mean, a government could decide to just default for, you know, absolutely bizarre political reasons. And we're seeing that in the US. There's a, you know, I don't expect a default, but, you know, hotheads are threatening a default. So, yes, I mean, a government can default at any time if they so desire. And this happens. I mean, but that's a political decision. Like, it's entirely a political decision. Do we raise the debt ceiling? It's not like the bond markets say, oh, no, you're going to default because of us. It's the U.S. Congress saying, oh, we don't want to change this number. Well, they change the number. Hey, the problem goes away. So it's a governmental decision. And, you know, we can find sufficiently crazy politicians who want to default. And so, yeah, it's theoretically possible, but it's not imposed by economic law of nature. My rule of thumb is I stay away from emerging markets on the basis that whenever an emerging market person talks about the developed government bond markets, they say stupid stuff. So I sort of say, well, I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to wade into their markets and say stupid stuff. I mean, they're different. But anyone relying on examples from Venezuela to talk about, you could say things could go horribly wrong, but it's pretty unlikely. Governments have to do things that are really stupid to get into the position that Venezuela. I mean, right now, I mean, things could go wrong and they could be forced into a bad situation. But right now, it's just not, it's not even a slightly plausible story.
Yeah, I think it's good, and Warren does this, to separate out ability to pay with willingness to pay when it comes to these things, you know. So, yeah, a government that issues its own currency can't, on a point of logic, be forced to involuntarily default on promises to pay denominated in the currency they issue. But just on a point of logic, you know, it's, but yeah, they could, of course, have a silly rule like the debt ceiling and voluntarily not pay.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, in finance textbooks, when I was studying fixed income, that was just standard. It was just a given. No one, they just, oh yeah, by the way, government bonds are risk-free because they can just, you know, they probably used bad phrasing, but yeah, I mean, it was just a given. I mean, that's why mathematical finance refers to a risk-free curve. And that was the explanation. So it's not really a completely out there idea. It's just, it's politically useful to pretend the government's going to run out of money.
And just to rewind a little bit, because we touched on inflation there. In the paper, the authors are a little upset that MMTers don't pay enough attention to the quantity theory of money. You know, it's not just MMT that's been critical of that, I guess. So, you know, it's been dismissed by all kinds of schools of thought, or the conditions that are put on the quantity theory of money identity are always up for questioning, I guess, is a better way to say that. Am I right, Dirk?
Yeah, I mean, the quantity theory of money, it can be roughly right in extreme times. Okay, so some of the monetarists of the UK, for example, pointed out that the US and also the UK would see high inflation rates because of monetary supply growth. I mean, yes, if you give lots of purchasing power to lots of people and then they can't do any shopping, and then you lift the restriction and then they can do shopping, yeah, well, then, of course, there might be a problem with stores running out of stuff and factories producing more, and then prices are rebounding, especially energy prices. So it doesn't take a genius to see that. But the idea that you can kind of predict what happens when you introduce another 100 euros into the economy, however you do it, by government spending or by exporting or by money creation through the banking system, we cannot know what will happen. And it's just not possible to say that an increase in the amount of money, however you define it, will cause this and that and will make inflation go up. And they are, in their paper, they have a couple of issues there where I would say, well, it's really an empirical issue. So if your theory predicts something and then it doesn't happen in the real world, you shouldn't be talking about that theory anymore. And for example, let me just read one thing to you here. They write, and I'm quoting now, even a temporary monetized fiscal stimulus. So this means if government spending goes up and then the central bank is buying the bonds, like all of them or most of them. So again, even a temporary monetized fiscal stimulus could trigger expectations, especially from the government, that a one-time use could easily become permanent. In turn, a permanent recourse to monetary issuance would lead to a flight from currency and to hyperinflation. But come on, all these governments, almost all of them have done that in 2020. Okay, so they all said, well, you know what? We just do bond issuance and we have like the pandemic emergency purchase program in the Eurozone. So let's just the central banks buy up lots of government bonds. We did it in the UK, we did it in the US, we did it in the Eurozone, we did it on a permanent basis for many months. We said we will continue to do this until the crisis is gone. But yet, here you find it written down once again that if you monetize fiscal stimulus, what will happen is a flight from currency and hyperinflation. And yeah, that probably means that we have a problem here because if we cannot start with the facts, and say that the theories have to explain the facts and not the other way around, then we're not having a debate. Because if what they think will happen in theory, if that never happens in reality, it doesn't make sense of us to continue talking about these kind of issues.
And I'll just jump in here and say that for anybody listening, in the show notes, I'll link to some of our episodes that deal with the MMT view of inflation. I just ask Brian quickly, this idea MMT doesn't have any ideas about inflation. I mean, what would you say to that, Brian?
Well, yeah, I mean, I won't lie. It's the hardest thing to write about for outsiders. From what I'm seeing, it's relatively complex. A lot of it I'm seeing goes back to sort of the post-Keynesian theories of inflation. And so you can sort of start debating, is this post-Keynes? But if we just accept MMT is part of the post-Keynesian tradition, then fine. There is a specific MMT flavor of discussion of inflation, sort of the inflation dynamics, but is this the consensus or like, I mean, I won't lie, it's relatively complex, but part of it is very simple. It's a bit, you know, theoretical, abstract, but it's the theory of the price level. So it's a theoretical point that the government sets the price level through its purchases, which is a big theoretical deal, certainly for Warren Mosler. And I agreed with him because, like, you know, what determines the price level in the neoclassical model? There's nothing that really works. There's one theory that works, but it's obviously wrong. And it solves that problem. But in practice, it's the job guarantee. The job guarantee is a tool, and it's a way of setting not necessarily a consumer price level, but a wage level. You're setting a wage level. It's a true minimum wage because you can actually earn it. You're guaranteed to earn it. And so it's used as an inflation tool. And the authors, I mean, once again, very bizarre. They sort of said it's like Pavlina Cherneva, like this was some, it's just a fringe view. It's actually a core part of MMT. That part of it is a core part. And the inflation stabilization with the job guarantee is actually easy to understand. And it's an important part of MMT. But if you want to talk about the world right now without a job guarantee, you have to start looking at, you know, other post-Keynesian theories of inflation. And yeah, that's, I mean, I'm not going to say that it's easy to summarize. But the theories exist, but, you know, it doesn't fit as well in primers. And really, you know, and it's also a description of a world that MMT wants to change. If once you put the job guarantee in, suddenly things are different, and that's what you want to do. The interesting thing is mainstream theory would have a very hard time dealing with the job guarantee. They would really have to reinterpret their models to fit a job guarantee world. I mean, it could be done. But it would destroy a lot of the internal logic.
I'd just say to anybody new here, maybe a way to start thinking about this, and you talked about it there, Brian, which is what Warren is now saying. Look, the micro foundation of MMT is that the currency is a monopoly, and monopoly is the easiest thing to understand in microeconomics, you know, that the price is set by the monopolist. You know, the monopolist tells you what you have to do to get the thing that they're issuing. And then add in the implications for what happens to the price level when the government, the issuer, doubles the prices that it pays or halves the prices that it pays. It becomes quite clear. That price level story becomes quite clear. So yeah, but when they turn to the policy proposals, the authors kind of get it half right on the proposals front. They write that, quote, full employment would be achieved through a public service employment program, which is how they refer to the job guarantee, which would act as an automatic stabilizer, and by large-scale spending on infrastructure, climate change, and the environment, dubbed the Green New Deal. Again, that's close quotes. Again, that second part is not part of MMT. I mean, Stephanie could say in the deficit myth, here's how I think we should use the power of the public purse. But when an MMT economist says this, you know, we should clarify that shouldn't be confused with MMT itself. Like you said, Brian, you know, that the job guarantee is core MMT, you know, and so my interpretation is, you know, that we're replacing the automatic stabilizer we have now, which is unemployment, with what many would regard as a superior automatic stabilizer, which is full employment via the job guarantee. That's part of MMT. But the Green New Deal per se is not part of MMT. In other words, the job guarantee is not the Green New Deal. It could be an important part of a Green New Deal for all kinds of reasons, but you know, MMT says implement a job guarantee, not implement a Green New Deal. I think that's fair to say. Would you agree, Dirk?
Yeah, well, there is no Green New Deal. There are many Green New Deals, and you have to be specific. So you are completely correct in pointing out that yes, I mean, MMT's core is these balance sheet operations. Like Warren always says, this is about reserve accounting. And then, of course, out of the reserve accounting comes the question, so if the government can create money and nothing stops it, if there's no political rules that stop it, then how do you create full employment? And then, of course, the job guarantee idea came up. And the job guarantee, I would also say, it's the only policy that belongs to the MMT core. But the rest of the MMT core is empirically falsifiable statements about the way that money is created and destroyed. So I think that also in their own discussion of MMT, they never lose a word about the failure of inflation targeting, which is very odd. Okay. So if you believe that if you put interest rates down, that somehow investment will go up and then more inflation results. Well, the last time we had a positive deposit rate in the Eurozone was 2009. Okay, so when I tell my students that interest rates can be non-negative, they cannot remember the time when they were positive. Okay, because they're 20 years old now, and they have been 8 when in the Eurozone interest rates were last above 1%, not starting with a zero. And it's, I mean, this is really also why MMT is coming up, because the inflation targeting policy they just don't have any answers. The only thing they do is move the interest rate around. And then through these kind of channels that they are posing there, they believe that somehow there's an effect on aggregate demand, and it doesn't happen. And I think there's a need to discuss, and Bill Mitchell does this very well, for example, in the book Shifting Sands, which is probably 15 years old by now. But we need to discuss why central banks, especially the ECB, why did it fail to reach its inflation target? And that's where we can then use MMT to create better policies. And that's what I would like to see in the next paper, to say basically, okay, look, what you want, full employment and price stability, is also what we want. So let's discuss how things work. And then we would have a debate. But if they're just, I don't know, creating some kind of straw man, and they're having lots of gaps in their own arguments, then of course it's not possible. But I kind of hope that the central banks will in the end bite, because they don't know what to do right now. They just don't. Of course, they pretend that nothing's happened, but they have no idea. I mean, nobody in the Eurozone believes that if we would put the ECB's deposit rate from minus 0.5% to minus 5%, that somehow private investment would pick up and inflation. Nobody believes that. But if nobody believes that, why are we still using these stupid models that they're using there? They're completely without any use. So we should... Yeah, we should go on. And I think MMT will provide the framework for the answers that we'll find.
So this has been a great conversation. Thanks to both of you. Before we run out of time, I just want to ask both of you what you'd like listeners to do or where to go online or otherwise to stay up to date with your work. And if there are any events coming up in that we might need to put in our diaries. So I'll turn to you first, Brian.
Well, I mean, I'm on Twitter. I'm not even sure my handle is. There's not many Brian Romanchuks out there, so it's easy to find me.
I'll put a link in the show notes for sure.
I have bondeconomics.com, but there's also a Substack, which is a little bit cleaner interface. And I do have a few popular books out there, but I'm working on another thing on inflation, but that's near its end. But the Substack or Twitter is where I'm visible.
And your books look great, and it's a mission of mine to make sure I get them all read.
They're short. They're handbooks. I designed them for ebook. And so they're small. They're too niche to show up in bookstores. So I can get away with making them shorter. People don't want to buy short books in bookstores. They want something big. But that's the thing. It's easier to read.
Yeah. And before we lose you, is it too soon to be talking about next year's European MMT conference?
Well, probably not. So yes, thanks for mentioning that. So the second European International MMT conference just happened last month, and you can check online. It's mmtconference.eu. And yeah, if you want to follow me on Twitter, you'll also find my Twitter handle in the notes, I guess. Then next year we'll just do it again. I think it was very good this time. We had MMTers and non-MMTers on panels, and they were discussing how to solve our problems. And I think this is a way to go forward, to just use MMT to create a better world and not get bogged down too much by discussions about who's right, who's wrong. I mean, we see that the new Keynesians, so the inflation targeting economists, they don't have answers, and clearly their models lack traction. So yeah, I think we already know that. So we can continue now and again start to design these kind of policies that hopefully are popular. And again, we're just economists, so we're living in democracies. If people tell us what they want, as economists, we can then create designs and then talk about how we can reach these kind of goals. But again, you are completely right in pointing out that MMT is in its core, it's an empirical theory about how money works. So once we start to discuss policy, it can be inspired by MMT or based on knowledge from MMT, but the policy reforms cannot be MMT itself. I think that's very important to point out. MMT is not a silver bullet, but MMT is probably helping us to think about solving the problems that we are facing right now.
I think that's a great place to leave it. I've been talking to Dirk Entz, economist and author of Modern Monetary Theory and European Macroeconomics, and Brian Romanchuk, analyst, writer at bondeconomics.com and author of Modern Monetary Theory and the Recovery. And I'll link to where you can find their work in the show notes for this episode. But for now, thanks so much for joining me today on the MMT podcast, Dirk Entz and Brian Romanchuk.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Christian.
That was the MMT podcast with Patricia Pino and Christian Riley. Don't forget, you can support the show through Patreon, starting at $1 a month, and get access to patron-only episodes. You can do that by going to patreon.com/mmtpodcast. You can also find me on Twitter at @mmtpodcast, and you can find Patricia on Twitter at Patricia N. Pino. And you can email us at mmtpodcast@outlook.com. Thanks for listening, and we hope to hear from you.